will now begin the second half of our oral sessions today. Formally, welcome. Thank you for joining us. I'm from travelling where you've come from. Some of you have come from quite a distance. So thank you for coming here to give us some evidence. So I'm Ruth Hart. I'm the chair of the Youth Select Committee on this inquiry into mental health. And just to remind you, we are specialising and looking more into awareness, stigma, services, and also education as well around mental health. And if you want to follow us throughout the day, you can also follow us on Twitter with hashtag YouthSelect. We've received over 140 pieces of submitted evidence, and we really look forward to what you can provide us today and what we can hear from you. The panel would firstly like to introduce themselves. If you'd like to start with you, Rebecca.
Hi, I'm Rebecca Moore. I'm the North Tyneside MYP, and I also chaired the North Tyneside Young Persons Health and Wellbeing Board for just over a year.
Hello, I'm Joshua Gray, and I'm the chair of the Kent Youth County Council Mental Health Committee.
I'm Kane Blackwell. I'm Kent Youth County Councillor and now Chair of Kent Youth County Council as well.
I'm Georgia Loynds. I'm from Oldham Youth Council and I'm also a DMYP.
Hi, I'm Toby Jeffery. I'm the Member of Youth Department for Bury St Edmunds in Suffolk.
Hi, I'm Saadia and I'm part of Newham Youth Council and I'm also a mental health champion.
That's great. Thank you so much. Again, thank you for coming. The first question I would like to ask you is, how would you describe the current standards and services provided by mental health? If you'd like to go first, Rebecca.
I feel that it's not enough as it is because there are long waiting lists, and I don't think that's right that young people are having to wait for services. Because realistically, if you have a mild mental health issue, the longer you leave it to wait for them to get into the service, the worse it's going to get. And the excuse is always, oh, we don't have enough money. But if you intervene earlier, so early intervention is key, I believe, then it'll cost you less in the future. And also the education's key, and there's not enough education in schools about mental health because it's not compulsory.
Thank you.
Yeah, there is not enough information about these services and about mental health in general. The lack of education is obscene, to be honest. There is no strict education laws regarding these, there is no training required for teachers, and therefore in this whole area there's just a very much lack of information regarding these services and regarding mental health in general, and that sort of needs to be changed.
So I have to agree with Joshua, as I'm also on the Kent Youth County Council mental health campaign. We did like a survey and all stuff like that, and we got some really interesting evidence from it, and people were they didn't know about these mental health services in their area. I've got something here that someone said, the only one I'm aware of is Childline, which is not necessarily a mental health organisation. Young people especially do not know about these services, and it needs to be publicised a lot more throughout counties and throughout the country as well.
Something that we found is that discussions that we've had with consultations that we've done in Oldham and also when we've been into schools is that the waiting lists are, as has been said, are too long. So things like CAMHS within the NHS, people feel like they are waiting too long. Now we've put this down to being things like CAMHS and medical professionals that deal with sort of higher level mental health issues, so sort of levels 3 and 4 as opposed to 1 and 2. Lower level mental health issues are being sent to the higher ones straight away. There's no early intervention and prevention, which we think is a real issue because that is what's creating the long waiting times. We've also had feedback saying from mental health organisations like CAMHS that young people have felt the responses from current counsellors are fake, and that they're just ticking boxes, and they've also felt that they have been discharged before their problems have been fully solved.
Thank you.
For my written evidence, I conducted a survey of several 11 to 18 year olds and asked them a series of questions. One of them relates to this question about services, and in response to that question, I'd like to quote a young person who responded to my survey, who's had some experience with this, and they say, "I live with depression, anxiety and associated panic disorder. My experience with the local mental health service in Suffolk has not been negative as such, but it has been frustrating. I self-referred in December to Suffolk Wellbeing. I wasn't given a face-to-face appointment until February, which was a huge waiting time considering how severe my situation was, and that they knew I was a danger to myself. Then I was then repeatedly referred to different branches, and it's taken me until this month, May, to finally meet with who is to be my permanent therapist and get some real help. This is just too long to wait. Within this time, I've had to rely on friends and family support, which has put considerable strain on all of my relationships, and as the support system is sometimes unreliable. In a situation as critical as mine, waiting for 5 months to get any help is actually dangerous. There have been several attempted suicides since my self-referral, and I've been lucky enough to get through it with no long-term damage caused. Others might not be so lucky. And from listening to young people in similar circumstances, I can tell the committee that this is a common scenario. Mental health budgets are being cut, and it's people like this respondent that suffer the most from it. And I think we've heard it throughout today, there needs to be a parity of esteem between physical and mental health in terms of funding. CAMHS needs a significant increase in funding, and I don't think we can be happy until referral waiting times are next to nothing, because we can't let this go on any longer. Considering that the majority of mental health problems start under the age of 18, it seems only logical that the majority of funding goes to CAMHS, and I'd predict that if you spend more money on young people's mental health, then you are not needing to spend a large amount on adults' mental health, because problems would have been identified from an early age, and more importantly, treated at an early age, so fewer adults are developing them.
Thank you.
I think on a regional or national scale, I think there's two reasons as to why services that provide mental health services are quite appalling. And firstly, it's because there's a lack of funding, and I've seen that across the board. Awareness, so many young people aren't aware of the services out there for them. I mean, in my local youth council, I made a suggestion as to whether anybody's heard of CAMHS, and one of the girls didn't even know what it stood for. I mean, it needs to be made more youth friendly. Kind of, CAMHS is just something that's not youth friendly to young people, which prevents them from going to seek help from CAMHS and those kind of organisations that don't seem to be kind of appealing to young people. But on a positive note, on a local level, in Newham, as far as I know, we've got a Newham Centre for Mental Health, and that service is run by the NHS, and it's an amazing organisation because they choose routes such as music therapy, aerobics, occasional therapy sessions to actually engage with young people and make them feel like that they can make a difference to their lives, rather than just, you know, what we've heard from the panel about ticking boxes and things like that. So I think that's the kind of approach that mental health services need to look at to better the services across a national level.
Thank you. I'd now like to pass over to Francesca.
Hi, Francesca. So we're going to start on the area of stigma and bullying. And so a lot of you have submitted evidence on behalf of young people around the stigma they face and the effect that this has on bullying and their academic achievement. And so can you describe how the stigma around mental health affects young people, and in particular what effect this stigma has on young people accessing services and the extent to which the stigma leads to bullying? I don't know where you want to start, Rebecca. Would you like to start?
Yeah, start. Well, with any issue, if you've faced stigmatism, then you're always it's always going to get you lower. And especially with mental health, where you're often already low, especially if you've got depression, when you've got stigma around it, that's just going to decrease even more your morals and the way you're feeling. And I don't think that and by having that stigmatism around mental health, it can be really quite demoralizing and upsetting to have. I know people who've had anxiety and have had to come out of the mainstream school system because they feel like people don't appreciate that they need a little bit of extra help. So if they're getting tables moved in the class, the teacher will need to tell them beforehand to make sure that they're prepared for that. And they just feel like the stigmatism around it is meaning that people are saying, oh, no, you're just making a big deal out of it. Oh, no, it's not a big deal. And that's just that's making people feel like my issue isn't worth talking about, and it isn't worth me seeking help and getting help, and I'm undeserving of this, which isn't fair. In terms of combating this, I think the main way, I'll say it again, is education. I think the key is teaching young people from such a young age about respecting others and understanding all sorts of issues, like sexual health is compulsory, finance education is compulsory, and it just seems ridiculous that mental health education isn't compulsory from a very young age.
Yeah, I agree completely there. Because of the lack of education, the stigma around mental health is going to continue. It's not going to stop, and it's going to continue to be prevalent, and will continue until these services are more readily available and better visible, and making it look like anything else. At the moment, mental health is treated as a sort of a separate issue. It shouldn't be. It should be treated as everything else. Everyone suffering from mental illness is the same as everyone else with any other illness. Bullying won't stop until young people understand what mental health is. Many of these responses, we had over 600 responses in our survey. Most of them, 20% of them understood vaguely what mental health was. I'm talking extremely vaguely here. When they understand what mental health is, when they understand the effects that it has on people's lives, something that's not taught today at all, and in the near future apparently won't be taught either, it's very unlikely that any sort of stigma or any bullying towards this will stop until the services and the education is readily available to everyone.
Yes, I have to agree as well. I think it's the bullying comes from ignorance. If it's not talked about mental health in the classroom, where I think it needs to be spoke about in the classroom, because that's where young people are every day of their lives. They feel comfortable in that environment. They feel safe in that environment. They know they can talk about it and talk about things and not feel threatened and feel like they're going to be jumped on for these opinions, because they've got a teacher there who will say, no, you know, this is your opinion, you've got to say this. But I think education is key. Once again, if it was spoke about more in PSHE lessons, and also in citizenship, sociology, and all these other lessons that link in with mental health, psychology, and all these other things, it would break down those barriers of talking about it and feeling comfortable saying, yeah, I do have a mental health issue, problem, and I'd like to get some help with it. And then people aren't going to go, oh, they've got mental health issues, and it's not really... So it's not brushed under the carpet. It's not really said, oh, right, we'll kind of talk about that separately or something. You're talking about it as a whole, as a community, and get it out there.
Yeah, just to reiterate what's already been said, I think the main problem with the stigma and bullying around mental health is ignorance. A lot of people, particularly if they haven't suffered themselves, don't understand what it's like or how it is just like having a physical illness. Because if you think about it, when you have a physical illness, people are willing to be there for you and to support you and to help you in whatever way they can, and they have sympathy for you. However, with mental health illnesses, people who don't really understand that it is really the same thing, they can feel uncomfortable, and they may not necessarily be deliberately mean or deliberately bully people because they have mental health problems. But the ignorance and the lack of understanding and the lack of compassion can mean that the young people suffering with mental health issues can become isolated and can be avoided by other young people and can feel like they can't really interact as much or participate as much. And I think one of the consequences of this is young people suffering with mental health issues is that they can either want to or need to take time out of school, which is making them unhappy, which is making them not want to be at school, which is obviously going to affect their education and affect their friendships and just their general well-being. So I think the key, as has already been said, is to normalise mental health issues and to really put it out there that it can't be helped, it does happen, and we do need to support people, and it is not something that people suffering should be ashamed of.
My survey highlighted a really worrying thing, and that's bullying definitely does exist. 63% of respondents said that they've previously witnessed bullying of students with mental health problems. And one respondent states that, and I quote again, "Self-harm is the most targeted by bullies, from what I've noticed, due to it being more obvious." They later go on to suggest that young people should be taught about the invisible mental health issues that people battle with. In response to that, I can only express shock that mental health is one of those things that can be seen as funny or open to bullying because of how badly it can affect some people. Those with mental health problems, let alone young people with mental health problems should be protected. And when they're in that sort of vulnerable environment, when they're open to bullying, being bullied is only going to make things worse for them and cause things like them having to take time off school, and that's a horrible thought. Horrible thought.
I think due to the stigma of mental health services, I think there's a cycle of disengagement with education and general school life. I remember talking to one of the girls as a mental health champion, and she said that when she walks into a mental health service, there's not that vibrant atmosphere. It's kind of like a daunting experience where you're like stuck in a box. That's quoting her words. And I think for a recommendation for the Youth Select Committee, I think there needs to be that kind of vibrant atmosphere in the mental health service, be that kind of young people actually getting up there speaking, educating other young people about mental health, not being from a 40-year-old man in a suit. You need that young person, you need that bond and that connection in order for them to actually feel relatable to the person that's giving them the advice. And there's evidence that individuals who retain more knowledge about mental health are less stigmatising towards the concept, and I think that radical approach to education really needs to be taken to allow them to have that kind of connection with mental health services.
Thank you. I'm just going to remind you, so many of you, Zeke, if you keep it, your answers brief, just so we can get through as many questions as possible. Thank you. Saz?
I was just wondering, you all mentioned quite a lot about the ignorance of people causing stigma and how education would be key in kind of removing some of that stigma, and you're all talking about education in schools. What do you think about, you know, education in the home, education of your parents? You know, obviously school for a lot of young people is a great atmosphere for people to for you to share your feelings and what you're going through, but also in a school atmosphere is also quite daunting for quite a lot of young people, and they would prefer to do it in the home. So,
Again. Well, there's no parenting handbook, is there? I do think ideally that would be one of the best ways to combat the stigma, because obviously if it's like drilled into you from a young age that it's wrong to stigmatise against young people with mental health issues, and that it's all about supporting them and being respectful and nice in a way. That would be ideal. I don't know how necessarily you could go about doing it, because there is no parenting handbook, as I said. But if anyone thinks of a really good way of doing that, then I'm all for it. I'll support you.
Yeah, I definitely think it's all about compassion and about helping parents just being nice to their children, to be understanding. And as there is no parenting handbook, there is no set way about going around this, it does make it very difficult for parents to target these sort of things, unless they've experienced it themselves. And obviously, if they've experienced it themselves, it's very likely they would have had education on it themselves. So maybe it's a progressive thing, sort of educating the youth of today, going up, this will improve lives in the future.
Yeah, I think it is a communication barrier, where I think if that was broken, where I think the NHS and leading organisations in mental health need to be saying to parents and other like guardians and stuff, telling them about how to spot mental health in their child or whoever they're looking after, and how to go about dealing with that, who they contact, how do they speak to that child. Like, again, you know, it is different for every parent, you know, it's not going to be the exact set way you go about it for every person, but there needs to be a sort of, in a sense, person you can go to for a parent to say, where do I go? What do I do with my child? Because I do think they have a mental health issue, but I don't know if to talk to them about it. I don't know if to talk to school about it. I think it's one of those things where it's communication.
Yeah, I think what we can't forget is that as well as it being difficult and uncomfortable for the young person to talk about, it may also be uncomfortable for the parents to talk about, especially if they haven't experienced it themselves. So I think, as has been said, parents don't always know what to do and where to start. And as we've said, school is a place where there's a lot of young people,
the teachers are trained to deal with young people. And I think there needs to be that school and home engagement more. I'm not saying, you know, teachers should ring up parents saying, yes, we think your child has a mental health problem. However, I do think that teachers and pastoral staff would be able and should be able to have the option to offer parent support and vice versa if they don't really know what to do with their child, because some parents are completely capable of dealing with their children's mental health issues, but some aren't. And I think schools are, you know, places that their children go on a regular basis and could really help with that.
We need to make sure everyone gets the messages. I think young people need to know what support services are available to them, how to identify a friend or family member who they think might have a mental health problem, and something else that's really important, what is and what isn't appropriate language to use when talking to someone with a mental health illness. And I think schools are the best places to learn these things for the reasons that the panel have given. As long as the teachers themselves are trained so that they can deal with these things, because the evidence that I've received shows that they currently aren't. We need to focus on that before we perhaps start using other places to deliver this information.
Yeah, I think it would be like a perfect world if you had that connection with your family where you could go and talk to them for support. But I think you've got to recognise that some mental health issues are caused by family relationships, so it may be difficult for some children to go and get that advice from a parent or so. Even some GPs say that they receive minimal training and they find it quite difficult to interact with young people, and a parent doesn't have that training, that education behind it. So I think, whereas it could be a really good alternative to schools, I think it should be the combined effort of both the school and the family.
Thank you.
Pia.
Hi, welcome to your select committee. Just to, I think you all actually hinted a bit about campaigns. For example, Ken, you've already got a mental health campaign. Saadia, you have had experience of campaigns. So what us as a youth select committee want to know is, what campaigns have you done in your local area, in your region, that we could use as a suggestion and hopefully to obviously expand on it? So can I start with Saadia, please?
So we had a mental health awareness day
in Newham. It was a really, really great event. We had an amazing turnout. I think it was about 2 years ago now. We had young people coming in. We had kind of like a drama play about mental health, kind of getting them active and not that kind of boring, daunting experience of mental health. It was that kind of positive atmosphere. We got GPs coming in, young people talking to GPs, so they're not seen as like an external figure that they can't go and relate to. It was that making that kind of contact between young people and services, having loads of services coming in and speaking to young people about what they can offer them and that kind of thing. I think it's just that kind of positive atmosphere that you need during campaigning sessions that you really need to implement, and I think it would be really helpful.
Thank you.
In Suffolk, we're still planning our campaign in terms of the Youth Parliament perspective, because obviously that's one of our national campaigns this year. But I will just make the point that I think it's really important to consult young people as much as possible when planning and delivering this sort of campaign, because obviously it's young people who are going to be affected by it. So I think doing things like a survey, I mean, over there we've seen 600 responses collected. I mean, I only had 54, but I still think it's worth considering as many young people's views as possible. It's worth doing things like surveys and consultations to make sure that we can reach as many young people as possible to hear their views on how we deliver the campaign, because they're the people that are going to be affected by it.
So one of Oldham Youth Council's main campaigns is our I Love Me campaign, which is a campaign all about self-esteem. And the main principle of it is basically to love yourself for who you are and to accept yourself. And a big part of our campaign focuses on mental health, as that seems to be a recurring issue. So we commissioned a theatre piece to go into schools called The Boy in the Black Box. And it was a theatre piece which looked not only at the stigma of mental health, but also how to spot the signs, say if you thought a friend was going through mental health issues, or it also dealt with sort of parents' reactions to it. And the main character was also a boy, because we felt like people sometimes thought it was mostly girls that suffered, even though young men are more likely to commit suicide than young women. So Oldham Youth Council worked really closely with Oldham Theatre Workshop, who put together this piece, and we consulted on it. and we got a lot of different young people's opinions as we what we wanted to go into this piece, just to target all the different issues surrounding mental health. And it was really successful, and it's also been picked up by Tyneside Council to be taken into Tyneside schools, so that's carrying on our campaign as well.
Thank you. Down in Kent, we are doing on KYCC, we're doing a mental health campaign, which was voted in by the young people of Kent. We did a survey, which was, we got responses from all over Kent, which is quite a big place if you've done Make Your Mark, which I have, which was very stressful. But we got over 600 responses, which was really good, from all across Kent. And we are now doing a directory, which we're going to put services across Kent into this directory, so we can promote it, and so then young people can look at this directory and see where my local mental health charity or organisation is, so I can go down there, or the drop-in centre, or somewhere like that. So yeah.
Yeah, we're also creating a presentation pack along with a lesson plan to give to teachers and to students, along with the emotional wellbeing policy, which is going out to Kent schools. This basically enables teachers to have an easy resource to show to teachers, whether that be in PSHE lessons or in assemblies, just to try and help the teachers to educate the students, because teachers don't have compulsory training on mental health. In our survey, only about 45% of teachers actually had training in any form on mental health, even though most of them actually wanted to training in the first place. But we've had these presentation and lesson plans will be going out to schools the next academic year to try and educate the people about mental health and where mental health services are.
Right. So last year, in about February, we finished a sexual health project, so we decided to move on to mental health, which we'd had for a couple of years, but kind of it'd been pushed to the side because of the sexual health project. So we wrote this report here, which I sent across to you, so you've probably seen it. And we consulted with all sorts of services and charities across North Tyneside, and also consulted with young people and chatted to them and got some results and things, which is all in there. So we named our project Mind Your Head, with an exclamation mark if you write that down. And because the original idea was to base it off the sign, but then we made a different logo thing because it looked better. So we've met with the PSA leads for our local authority and spoke to them about the project, and we have created a lesson plan and some resources for teachers to teach to young people, and we've had a lot of the schools sign up in North Tyneside. There's also a few other projects in North Tyneside that I can chat about if you want me to, or if you wanted to move on.
But short time.
Yeah.
But if you want to send us any more information or any,
yeah, can do.
We'd be more than happy to read that.
Yeah.
Liam?
Thank you. My name's Liam. Nice to meet you all. Just want to say a huge thank you for coming to give evidence to our committee. The committee does understand that self-harm is a major issue and a thing that does occur in today's society, and although it does occur, it is also underreported, and evidence does suggest this. We just wanted to ask, due to the limited amount of time that we've got, I'm just going to allow to ask three people this question. We've limited the amount of people that can answer this question. Does the fact that self-harm is a taboo subject make it harder to tackle websites that promote it, and how can we tackle websites that promote self-harm? Becca, do you want to have a go at answering it?
Well, that's a massive issue, like romanticising self-harm, especially for like bands and things. I mean, you've probably all heard Cut for Bieber and things like that. Mm-hmm. And I think it's really wrong that people are promoting self-harm. A lot of people do turn to it because they have no other way, but the way it's being presented in the media as being a good thing to do and a show of like support towards a band or someone else is, I don't think that's right. In terms of stopping that, I think it's the accounts, and it's mainly Twitter, I find, and Tumblr, I'm not on that. I think it's more contacting those organisations and making them have stricter guidelines and stricter ways of shutting down websites and accounts that promote self-harm. So I think it's mainly speaking to the organisations who set them up and having stricter laws on what's appropriate and what's not on the internet, especially around age gaps and things.
So I'm really keen to answer that question. Yeah.
Okay, so, whoops. yeah, I agree absolutely with everything that's been said. However, this is not me promoting these websites at all. However, I have found from people that I've spoken to personally, people that go on these websites and sort of, there's a lot of blogs with sort of self-harm pictures and posts. The people on these websites talk to each other, and from what I've heard, they actually help each other. You know, they discuss their feelings, they discuss their emotions. You know, random people on the internet telling each other, you are worth it, you don't deserve to self-harm. And I've been told that this does actually help some people. So I'm not saying we should promote self-harm, however, I'm saying these websites do some good. Also, I think that if people are searching for these keywords to do with self-harm, they should be redirected to where they can get help. I know on Instagram, how you search the hashtags, if you search things like hashtag self-harm, a little message comes up which says, I can't remember exactly what it says, but it's something to do with, you know, this could be potentially triggering material, would you like to be redirected to some services? So I think that needs to be enforced a lot on every single website when people are searching keywords like that.
One more person. Do you want to add something, Saadia?
I just think that if people go on websites, I mean, I remember somebody written evidence that there was a stigma, not stigma, there was a self-harm website where they were selling self-harm products. And I think it's just about the education, because young people are going to be less likely to be persuaded by these websites if they were educated enough to not go there. I mean, there's pastoral managers in school, and I remember that in one... At my school, we had a pastoral manager who had this day where we had like a self-harm awareness day, and they kind of told us about the harms of internet security and things like that. So I think that kind of education will then deter people from actually going on these websites, and just that kind of double thinking before clicking onto these websites that could be dangerous to their health.
Thank you.
Thank you. Brian?
Hello, and welcome. I'm going to talk about the awareness of things. I know some of you have done consultations of your own in the past. So bearing that in mind, can you describe from your experience and consultation, how aware are young people of mental health?
I think on a large scale, they're not very aware of the services. I think from hearing from young people, they think that social media would be an absolutely amazing way of connecting with services and young people, because, I mean, they're all over Twitter. You see the hashtags, you see all these young people interacting with each other, like getting to know each other, and I think that would be like an amazing way in which people can engage with mental health services. I know that there's been this organisation called Motivate East, and they've been working in East and North London with disabled people that have mental health issues, and getting them involved in sport and just advertising that across schools is a really good way in which people can be aware of services that are out there for them. And I just think, yeah, just building up advertising, because it's not advertised as much as preferable.
I'm going to go straight back to my survey again, because 45.3% of respondents wouldn't be sure of where to go if they wanted to speak to someone about mental health. Quite simply, I don't think the services exist in the first place. Recently, I challenged myself to find a helpline in Suffolk to call if I ever wanted to speak to someone about mental health. I couldn't. The main service is Childline, and I don't think it's at all fair to rely on them to help young people with mental health queries. Even my local CAMS website directed me towards Childline. They didn't have a phone number, just Childline. All of this is assuming that young people don't want to speak to their GP. And from what I've gathered, the majority don't. They're scared of being handed prescription drugs to be used as a quick fix to what could be a serious problem. I think that there needs to be a single phone number or reference point for any young person that needs to speak to someone about mental health. But from what I understand, there's no funding for it, and there should be funding made available. Really quickly, one young person told me about their mental health that, and I quote, "Until now, I haven't had the confidence to tell anyone, and it took me months to pluck up the courage." Talking to someone about mental health, I believe, shouldn't be a scary thing. It should be normal, because it's quite normal to have a mental health illness.
Thank you. Parents?
Hi, I'm Terrence.
And the question I'll be asking today is, how should mental health education be improved? Can I ask Saadia, Kane and Joshua to give me a bit of information on that? So, Saadia, if you don't mind.
Well, firstly, I think across the panel we've identified that there's not that compulsory education of mental health in schools, and I think embodying that in the national curriculum will be amazing for young people to get that knowledge, first-hand knowledge from teachers. That, can I just recommend, those teachers need to be trained in the topic of mental health, because you get CPSHE lessons that are taught by science teachers and it's just like, I can't relate to you because you're a science teacher and quite frankly you know nothing about mental health most of the time. And I think that needs to be embodied in national curriculum from year 9. I think that's the most suitable year to be able to gain knowledge about mental health, because that's kind of like where you're picking up things from the internet and puberty and things like that, and I think it would just be a really good age in which people can get that information and readily available for future references.
Well, in Kent, like I say, we did a survey, and we also did a teacher survey as well as a young person survey, and we kind of got from that that teachers do want to have mental health tech training. So we found out that 93% of teachers in Kent who did the survey and turned it back said they would like to do a mental health training course. 93%. 7% said no. That's only 7%. 93% said they would. They said, and then also we asked the question, what training have you had? None, 45, some, 29, and a lot, 26. It just shows that we do need our teachers to be mentally health aware and trained in this region. So yeah, that's what we found out.
Yeah, there is a massive flaw in the national curriculum. There is no information in the national curriculum or outlined by Ofsted about what schools should put in there. There is no information, there are no lesson plans given by the government. And seeing as the government is so aware of the issues regarding mental health at the moment, maybe they should have definitive either lesson plans or guidance for teachers and for schools to provide the education, not just to students, but to teachers. Because a lot of teachers have to help with people with mental health problems on their own without training at all. And this is a big issue, because the students themselves aren't getting the correct training there. The teachers don't know where the services are, where services are available. And the parents, if they go into the schools to ask information, they won't get anything useful. Education across the board for everyone in schools and around schools is very, very poor. And that has to be improved in some way or another, whether it's using PSHE lessons or anything around school, whether it be assemblies or anything. It just needs to be improved.
Thank you. Ewan?
Hello, I'm Ewan. This leads on quite well to what you were just saying there. So I'd like to ask yourself, Rebecca and Georgina, what kind of things relating to mental health do people want to learn about in things like PSHE, but that could also be outside the home as well?
Yeah, it's almost everything. I mean, the responses that we got from what is your definition of mental health were shocking. It's the basics in this area are terrible. People do not know what it is at all. People are just saying someone's well-being or I don't know is not good enough. People don't understand the issues relating to mental health. There isn't the education across the board to teach people about that in the first place. But a lot of the time people want to know where the services are. People who are experiencing these, and a lot of the time they don't even know they are experiencing them, need to know where to get services. Schools should have a database or a directory of services that they have. They can direct people to specialists in the area. They know what they're talking about to help the students across the board.
The main thing that we found was, again, people don't really know what it is, and the thing that we fundamentally think that everyone should know is that everyone has mental health, whether it's good or bad, and that it's not just, oh, you've got mental health, it's you're having a slight issue with your mental health at the minute, and we're going to try and move it, get it better so you're happy. And it's about how everyone's mental health fluctuates, and it's not always going to be the same throughout your life, and different things will make it go up and down. And again, it's about teaching about how depression. It's not just you're down, it's you're really down. And it's not just anxiety, you're not just being a drama queen. You've got a genuine issue there that does need help.
Thank you.
What we found is that mental health education in schools is that you probably have maybe one assembly on mental health, maybe a year, if that. And like with most assemblies, nobody listens and nobody remembers what's said. And I think that's the main issue. Maybe it's the way the information is put across, maybe it's too formal because it's obviously delivered by teachers who, as the panel have already said, maybe don't know how to engage with young people when it comes to speaking about mental health. Another problem is that people don't know how to approach their peers about mental health, whether it be their friends, whether it just be someone in school that they're worried about. People seem kind of scared to approach the subject as if it's a taboo subject. It's all about understanding it's this parallel with physical health. You know, they need to know what they should do, what they should say if they think someone's suffering, where to direct people for support, how to get support themselves if they need it. And they just really need it, that information delivered to them in a way that they'll engage with and that they'll remember.
I think the topic, the way in which we're saying that we're going to give young people kind of guidance on what services are out there for them, I don't think that's enough, because even if they are given services that they can go to, it's that caution of not going there. Even though you know it's there, you're not going to go there because you don't feel that they're relatable. And that leads back onto your question of how to get these young people, what do they actually want to learn? And I know from speaking to young people that they want to see real life scenarios so they can be relatable to those people that suffer mental health and say, hey, they went to a mental health service, I'm quite like them, and therefore I can go too. And I think it's that kind of relatability that they need to learn through things like videos and music, something that will actually retain in their memory, not just the kind of formal assembly that we obviously disagreed with on the panel.
Thank you. Laura?
Hi, I'm Laura. Moving on to the topic of communication, as you're fully aware, young people think that adults do not communicate well with them about mental health, and teachers, counsellors and doctors are often found to be ill-informed, patronising and intimidating. So some of our evidence suggests that teachers and doctors might not be able to get through to young people about mental health and be approachable enough. So, Toby and then Joshua, could you explain why that might be?
I think, I think social media is a fantastic tool that is not used nearly half as much as it should be to engage with young people. It's where young people are. I always joke that it's my second home. When there are accessible resources made available to young people about mental health, it could be extremely beneficial. I just see it as an idea worth experimenting with, because, as I said earlier, if you go to the Suffolk CAMS website, web page as it is, you get directed towards Childline. Why not be directed towards accessible videos, resources, or social media accounts where they can gain concise, quality information about mental health that young people so desperately need? Because obviously this is a thing that isn't being recognised enough. Even though you see young people committing suicide and self-harming and visible signs of distress, and it's not being tackled by those that should be really looking after them. So I'd just go with social media and accessible resources.
Yeah, the services aren't very old-fashioned at the moment. They are institutionalised. They are, okay, you go into this building, we will sit you down, and we will tell you about what your problems are, tell you how to solve it, and that's not what it should be. We've improved a lot since the 1980s, when everything was very much institutionalised. More involvement with the young people is necessary. They need to have relevant discussions about it, not just, obviously, in these organisations, but in schools and elsewhere, and online, for example. The whole point is that this institutionalised service, which is just very out of date, and CAMS is one of these, no matter how they improve it, they will continue to stay with this same basis of having a room where you go in and you talk to someone, and that doesn't work, and that's been proved not to work. So online, elsewhere, in schools, is definitely the way to go.
Thank you.
From the evidence we've had submitted to us so far, we found attitudes from young people saying that they find doctors and counsellors unwelcoming when they receive treatment, How can doctors and counsellors be more welcoming to create a better environment for young people who seek treatment? Rebecca?
I think everyone always talks about the options for if you've got a mental health issue is go to your doctors, go to counselling. There's so many other ways of getting better. I think mindfulness is a massive tool that needs to be used more, and that's really good for early intervention, especially during exam periods. Like, you're so stressed, and if you just go into a room and you've got a calm person stood at the front chatting to you and making you like relax, I think that should be used more. In terms of them being unwelcoming, I think it's all about the environment that you go into. I went into a school nearby me, and they had like a hut which they went in. You go in and the radio's on and it's all colourful, magazines that are up to date, and it was such a lovely, calming environment for that school nurse worked in. I think it's all about just making the actual area that you're waiting in or you go into more welcoming, and just colours is what I'm saying. Make it bright and colourful and pretty.
Thank you. And also, Saadia?
I've been into, like, not for mental health, but I've been into GPs and doctors and things, and they just don't smile. I mean, if you're going into, like, a mental health problem, like, the least a GP or doctor could do is smile at you to make you feel that you're welcome there, like, they actually want to help you. I think, yeah, literally, just smile. Yeah.
I'm now going to pass to Rowan.
Thank you, Rhys. As Rhys mentioned, I'm Rowan. I would like to talk a bit about involving young people. One of the recommendations in North Tyneside submission was to use young people. We can be better at talking to other young people than adults. And I know this was echoed in the Kent Youth County Council's and the Newham Council submissions. So how do you think that young people could be involved in both the decision-making process and in supporting peers in mental health services? Can we start with you, Rebecca, and then go to Kent, and then finally Saadia and you?
Well, I don't know whether you've ever heard of an organisation, it's closed down now due to funding, but it was called Mindful, and that was a website that you went online to, and young people are trained as mindful mentors, and young people who were having a bit of a down day or something could log on and have a chat to someone, and it was regulated by counsellors. Unfortunately, due to funding, that was shut down. But as we said in our application, in our written evidence, we think that you should use young people, and young people who feel comfortable talking about their experiences going in and chat and talking to young people who are learning about mental health, because I mean that's what hits home more. If you've got someone coming in saying I went through this experience, here's how I got better, and here's how I can help you. And I just think that's a really good way of peer mentoring, especially if they're close in your age gap, because you can kind of look up to them a bit and relate to them.
I do think we need to involve young people, especially in the decision-making process, and also just, yeah, being around people who do have mental health issues. It makes sense to ask young people who are going through mental health issues to talk about and make decisions about mental health. It's, why would you ask an old man in a grey suit to say, what should we do about young people in mental health services, when they are not in touch with young people in mental health services? It makes sense for a young person to do it. That I think we need to push more for that as an organisation, and as, you know, as a campaign and stuff like that.
Thanks. Saadia?
I think it's kind of youth councils and MYPs, because they have that connection between with young people. I think before we had the Mental Health Awareness Day in Newham, nobody knew what a mental health champion was. And it was during that campaign that I kind of drilled into young people about why you should become a mental health champion, why you can use your experiences and help other young people better their health. I mean, it's just that kind of getting involved with your youth council and then joining campaigns, and then you learn more about what kind of roles there are out for you, whether it be mental health champion or whether it just be helping at your local service, mental health service. So I think just keeping up with what youth councils are doing and MYPs connecting with the schools and young people and getting them involved.
Thanks.
Just to really round you up, obviously I've heard everyone on what you've been saying, but the last question's about the peer support, where every one of you have touched upon that. But specifically, I want to ask Toby, because you've conducted a survey, so your opinion would really benefit us specifically, and also Saadia with your mental health champion. So what I really want to know is how effective are the peer support programmes like Mental Health Champion, and what are benefits and what are the drawbacks, so we can, you know, gather the evidence to see whether they are useful. Can I start with Saadia, please?
I think the main benefit is the fact that there's so many young people that are mental health champions, and then that's how you've got that connection with young people actually building these services for other young people. I think that's probably the main benefit that there is. The drawback is kind of, I don't know, like, I think them actually having a relatability to a lot of young people. I just think there's more benefits definitely to these kind of peer support units, because you actually have a chance to sit down and talk to young people rather than just being confined into an environment with like a GP or a doctor. I think the main drawback would just be kind of having that gut instinct to go in and do and to be part of a peer support. I think that's the kind of like, that's probably going to be as a result of less stigmatisation would actually benefit that. I think that's probably the problem, where young people aren't going to seek help because of that stigma. I think once that's kind of decreased, then you have that really efficient peer support system. Thank you.
Yeah, I can only really echo some of the comments that have been made across the panel, but I will say that one of the most inspirational pieces of advice that I'd ever been given was in an assembly, but it was delivered by an ex-service user, still a young person, I think just over the age of perhaps the oldest member of this committee, but it was such a fantastic assembly because it seemed relevant. It seemed like we could all benefit from what they had to say. And a scheme like that across the country, where perhaps ex-service users could deliver what will be a very similar piece of information to the groups they go to, I think so beneficial, because I think Mental Health Champions, I'll be completely honest, I hadn't heard of them until today, because it's kind of a postcode lottery. Some areas have them, some areas don't. Suffolk doesn't, not to my knowledge anyway. So a scheme like that, where just young people are talking to other young people rather than the sort of grey suit idea, would be, I think, fantastic and so beneficial for the young people that are suffering and don't know how to speak to someone. An ex-service user is the perfect person to go to, I think.
Thanks very much.
Thank you. I'm going to ask you all one final question. If you could see anything in the report, or you could make any recommendation to government, what would your recommendation be? So I'll start with you first, Rebecca.
Children and young people's mental health services, and also early intervention. So I mentioned mindfulness earlier. Other tactics that aren't necessarily the conventional. You go into a room, you chat to a counsellor, because that doesn't always work for every young person. I think a lot of it is early intervention and just teaching young people about mental health in different ways.
Thank you.
Education. It has to be education. Educating teachers, making sure every single teacher gets a course either on inset days or during their teacher training, their PGCSEs. They have to have the training to allow the education to go through the system, to go through to the children, to the young people. It's so important to make sure in schools, especially because everyone has to go to school between the ages of 11 and 16, it's so important to get the education in then, get it early, so everyone may be able to help cope later on in life.
I have to agree with Josh. I think education is the main key. I think there needs to be legislation to say that mental health should be taught in PSHE lessons, like financial studies and all these other things like sexual health. It needs to be there, so then there will be no stigma. If you talk about things like sexual health and all these things, there's no stigma around it. People will go, well, this is where you can go. People will be able to pick up on things and say, well, I've heard of this place you can go, and I've heard of this place who can help about this and stuff like that. It's about making it accessible as a community in schools.
Thank you.
Just to reiterate what some of the panel have said, I think it is about not just the education, sort of educating people around mental health, but we really, really need to tackle this stigma. We, as young people, and obviously the adults, need to be more compassionate, because I think what a lot of people don't understand is that anybody can suffer with a mental health problem just as easy as anybody can suffer with a physical health problem, and that's what we really need to be tackling. You know, you never know when you might need that help. You know, you people won't get help until they feel like they're accepted and like they're not going to be made fun of. It's like, you wouldn't feel ashamed walking into the doctor saying I have the flu. You wouldn't feel ashamed walking into school saying I have a broken leg. So you shouldn't be ashamed to go into any place and say I have a mental health problem, because it's completely normal, and that's what we need to hit on with.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think my recommendation, slightly different, would be a comprehensive review into funding for CAMHS. And I think this is crucial because waiting times are so long when it comes to referral. After you've made the brave decision to speak out about what you might think is a mental health illness, you might have to wait months and months and months to actually sit down in a room with someone who is trained to deal with your problem. And in my first comment, I mentioned the experiences of a young person who's been through this process. And there's been attempted suicides during those times. More funding, and I believe currently it's somewhere between 6% and 8% for CAMHS, and yet 75% of mental health illnesses start under the age of 18, and I don't see the link. 6% to 8% is not enough, and there needs to be more, and with that money, waiting times will be reduced, more staff will be available to help the young people that seriously need it. And apart from that, thank you for the work you're doing on this, and I look forward to the report.
Thank you. Thank you. Saadia?
I think, again, the national curriculum at year 9, before the stress of GCSE kicks in, I mean, there needs to be that kind of education, and we will get that. There needs to be the mental health incorporated, if it is incorporated into CPSHU, with ex-mental health service users talking to young people. And if the government says, you know, we've got too much stress in science, maths and English, I mean, it just doesn't hurt to just do like an assembly or like one lesson a week on incorporated with your CPSHE lessons, delivering things that can help young people, advertise services for them and things like that. I think it definitely can be incorporated, and the government needs to look at that to instill that in the national curriculum.
Thank you. And with that, I'll close this panel. So that is the end of our fourth panel today. And thank you ever so much for joining us and finding us for this information. It's been great. Thank you.
Cheers.
Thank you.
It's brilliant. That's perfect. Thanks, my love. Cheers, Els.
I'm sorry. I'm quite there yet.
Which is council,
I'm Anna. Lovely to meet you.
Yeah,
good, weren't
they?
That
was nice.
Oh
my
gosh.
That's what you say first, anyway. They're quite good.
Did you see me down there? Bloody good, they are.
They're so good, aren't they?
Yeah. Let's kick out the current government and get this one in.
One of them is so on it. Not like hands hold us down. So, what does that mean? What are they talking about?
If people could take their seats, you're about to start, thank you. Okay, so firstly, welcome. We'll now begin our fifth panel of the day. So I'm Rhys Hart, I'm the chair of the Youth Select Committee. Thank you so much for joining us and giving us your time.
Pleasure.
If you'd like to introduce yourself, say a bit about yourself and the organisation representing, that'd be great, thank you.
Sure. Yeah, so I'm Anna Williamson, nice to see you all. It's a bit lonely on this after the last one. I feel like I should have draped myself across the table. So I'm Anna Williamson, and I'm an ambassador for Mind Charity, Deputy Ambassador for Mind. I'm also a TV presenter, journalist, counsellor and life coach. And that's all because of my own past history suffering with mental health issues.
That's great, thank you ever so much. So just a bit about what will happen is we'll ask you questions and just prepare as well. We know you're comfortable speaking about your experience.
You
and
can
that's
ask whatever
great.
You want. For me, it's the whole point as well today is to get to the nitty gritty. So please don't feel you have to tread on any eggshells. That's what I represent really.
That's brilliant, thank you. The first question is from Laura.
Hi, I'm Laura. Thank you so much for coming today. We really appreciate it. First of all, could you tell us about the work that Mind does, and in particular what it does for young people?
Sure. So Mind Charity is the number one mental health charity, and what we do is offer a service nationally for everybody that needs to have somewhere to go when they're feeling they've had a rubbish day at work, rubbish day at college, or whatever it may be, or obviously to the complete opposite end of the spectrum as well, mental health issues, if they need help. So it's a service which is available for people to call. There are support forums. We have a forum called Ellie Friends, which is a fantastic support forum where people can log on and speak to sort of like-minded people just to get some support, you know, giving them a bit of G up throughout the day if they need it. And nationally, we roll out various, each sort of borough or different areas have their own service which they're responsible for themselves. So that is essentially what we do at Mind, but you know, like everything, we, you know, one in four people suffer from a mental health issue, and we need more money to be able to answer more calls. And I've actually just schlepped myself up and down the Three Peaks Challenge, well, Mind 3000, to earn to raise £60,000 for Mind, in order to ensure that we can answer the, I believe it's 40% of calls that we can't actually answer at the moment due to the high volume, and that we're seeing it increase all the time.
Thank you. Question 7.
Alright, so my question to you is, what work do Mind Ambassadors do?
Okay, so Mind Ambassadors can do all kinds of different things. I mean, my particular role as an ambassador is to raise awareness of mental health issues, raise awareness of our charity, and the people that are involved in it, and what we offer. We know how desperately people need to have services that aren't available because of cuts, which is ludicrous, and it's something that makes me personally extremely angry, where charities such as Mind are having to pick up the shortfall, and we can't cope with the increased numbers that are coming through to us. We do cope, but only just. So as ambassadors, I'm there to raise awareness, I'm there to help raise funds, I'm there to help, like I say, do ridiculous things like take myself up a mountain without any sleep for 24 hours with some incredible people. So it's really raising awareness, it's destigmatisation as well, which is something that really gets my goat and something that as a nation we have to seriously change. So that's what we're working towards and we'll continue to work towards until we get those services that are needed to be rolled out nationally.
Thank you. Saskia?
Hi, I'm Saskia. We were just wondering, how can people get involved in supporting the mental health charities?
So, I mean, the main thing that people can do with regards to mind, so I think anybody that you know wants to get involved, and quite frankly, that should be everybody, you know, in my opinion. You know, it is a shocking statistic. I think that one in four of us suffers, you know, will suffer at some point from a mental health issue. Now, for some people, you know, that could be quite scary, I think, but it really isn't to be scary. You know, I am that one in four, and I'm sure in this room, well, statistically, you know, there's going to be a few more of us in here, you know. In my role is to kind of normalise it a little bit as well. You know, it is normal. Everyone has mental health. I know one of the young ladies said it in the last session. Everyone has mental health. It's just sometimes we have a little bit of a, you know, need a tweak, you know, a little bit of TLC. So for everyone to get involved really in mental health charities, I think is absolutely fundamental. I think charity starts at home, so let's start looking after ourselves. So by getting in touch with Mind at mind.org.uk, there are various ways that people can help fundraise and lend their help and their support, and essentially find out, even just people curious, just find out what Mind do, what mental health is. You know, let's not be scared about it. Let's start understanding it, and that is the key to it. The more we understand it, the more it doesn't become a taboo anymore.
Thank you. How would you describe current mental health services?
I think my laugh says it all, really, doesn't it? I'm quite embarrassed, really, about for this, you know, this nation at the moment. That I know we're not a bottomless pit. Of course we're not. Everyone has their own cause. Yes, of course they do. But again, when we, you know, the amount of the millions of people, I can't remember the last figure to date, but I believe it's around 14 million. It might be more than on antidepressants. That's an enormous section of the population. To cut mental health services when one in four suffer from a mental health issue, and the knock-on effect that a mental health problem can have on everything in life, that's business, family life, future, finances. You know, let's look at government spending, you know, early intervention, which I know people are saying it's something I'll come on to as well. By actually investing in everything now, which we are, because mental health services are rubbish at the moment, they aren't sufficient enough at all. CAMHS kick people out, and I'm a big fan of CAMHS, but they can't do it. You know, they physically can't meet that demand, and then there's this transition period. What happens when people go into the abyss, you know, and moving into adult life? It isn't just something that you can just, you know, to pass someone over. We need to start investing in it now, not cutting it, because the more we, in my opinion, and from what I see, the more we start to invest in it now, we're actually going to save ourselves a hell of a lot of time, money, resources as a national thing, because it affects everything, you know, not by intervening. All kinds of things can happen. Self-medication happens, you know, all kinds of further problems. So you end up starting to treat the symptom, not the actual problem. And so, and there you waste even more money in the big, you know, pool of cash that we don't have as a nation. But for me, the current services are absolutely ludicrous. And it's time this government woke up and actually realised they need to put money into this, because it isn't just about mental health, actually. It's about a huge, bigger picture, which everybody has plays a part in.
Thank you.
Sorry, I get a bit passionate about this.
No, it's good. could you possibly tell us about your experience with mental illness?
Yeah. So, I mean, I'm very well documented at, you know, trotting out my past, but I suffered 10 years ago with panic disorder and general anxiety disorder, which is a very lovely little label that I got. But when I first felt like how I was feeling, I hadn't got a clue what was wrong with me. It felt like I was losing my mind. I felt like I was a mad woman. You know, I am going to use these words, whether they're, you know, right or wrong, because it was how I felt at the time. And I was working at the time. I was presenting a kids' TV show where I was very up there, very energetic, very pressured. I loved it. but through feelings of this sort of, the only way I can describe it is sort of living my life through a fog. It felt like I was sort of living through a frosted panel of glass. Every morning I'd wake up with this dread of the day ahead. Didn't know why, felt very lonely. However, I've got wonderful family and friends. It didn't matter. It doesn't matter. This is the whole thing. And the worst thing anyone can ever say to anybody in general, whether or not they're suffering from low mood, is, oh, think of someone else that's worse off than you. Because in the here and the now, there is no one worse off than you. And that pressure and guilt you feel only exacerbates the situation you're in. So I was in that situation going, why am I feeling like this? You know, I've got the best job in the world. There are a billion people that want to be a kids' telly presenter. I have a great life. I happen at the time to have had a pretty crappy boyfriend, excuse my language, which was sort of part of the problem, and the increased stress that I was feeling around that, emotional stress, I'm quite a sort of, you know, sensitive person, and it just tapped into that part of me, and I developed, and again, going back to the sort of the symptoms creating even more problems, had I known how I was feeling was actually a something, and I actually wanted the label, and I was, it was brilliant when I got one, because I just thought I was completely weird and had lost my mind, and you know, what on earth am I going to do the rest of my life, because I just could not see a way forward. And I carried on, and you know, got more and more insomnia, panic attacks, all those horrible feelings that come with that, and eventually, you know, something imploded, and that was it. I was at work and had a rather embarrassing, you know, taxi out the back door. And actually, the network I worked for at the time, still work for, were brilliant. A great example of how HR in the workplace should work and should kick in. And I went to see a doctor. And it wasn't until I saw, it was actually a very specialist doctor, a psychiatrist, which sounds very dramatic, but it was the only one. And this is the other thing. I haven't got a clue where to go to. You know, I'm feeling a bit weird. Feeling a bit rubbish, don't know how, you know, I don't understand what this is. And it was thanks to my mum, who happened to work for a consultant psychiatrist, that went, well, he's the only person I know that works in matters of the mind, so to speak, let's go and see him. And he was a revelation. I walked in for him, for someone just to totally get it in an instant and go, oh, right, so this is happening in life, this is happening. Well, of course you're going to feel like that. You've got anxiety disorder, let's fix it, let's work your way through it. And I did, and it was great. However, I was in a very privileged position where I had the funds to pay for it privately. Had I not known of who to go to through a family member, I would have been stuffed. And quite possibly, genuinely, I probably wouldn't be on the telly now, because it got so bad. At the time, I wanted to run away and just think, everything will be all right if I just leave my job, leave London, go live in a caravan by the sea somewhere. Everything's going to be fine. That's not the answer, and that's the problem. People think that that is the way they need to go, but it's the illness that's taking over, and it's the early intervention that is absolutely key.
That's great, thank you. Again.
Hey Anna, welcome to your select committee.
Hi.
Obviously, it is a pleasure to know your experience, because I'm sure everybody who will be watching this and reading this can relate to that as well. So my question, which leads to your experience, is can you explain why you and many other people have felt afraid that they have suffered from mental health illness, especially linking to the stigma attached to mental health illnesses?
Why so many of us have suffered it,
why they're afraid to say they are suffering with it.
Because you're going to feel like you're a freak. That's the why people don't say it. You feel like you're a complete weirdo, and you feel that everyone's going to judge you. You feel like the only one. And you're scared of the unknown. And this is the thing, you know, when we talk about physical illness and mental health illness, you can see a physical illness. We get it. Other people get it. And this is what I find with mental health. The more and more I preach it, I learn about it, and I talk about it, is it's actually managing other people's feelings and their emotions. And when you are suffering from mental health illness, you can't even think about your own, let alone someone else's. Mm-hmm. And I meet a lot of people pleasers, of which I was at the time, that do that. So you're actually trying to sort yourself out whilst guarding yourself against everyone else's feelings and not having them judge you. And you do feel that label is going to stick. If someone has a broken leg and they're off work or they're off school or whatever, we get it. They've got a broken leg. Of course they can't come in. Won't ask a question. We'll probably send them a card and some chocolates and that'll be great. Oh, they're off work or school because they've got depression or they've got anxiety or they're not too sure, but they can't come out of house. Well, they're weird. You know, straight away people, like, I think the tide is starting to turn on that because people are realising they're not on their own now with it, but we've only just touched on it at the moment. And that is why I was afraid to say how I felt, because I was looking around me thinking, everyone is going to think I am nuts and I'm going to lose my job. And that's truly how I felt. And that is when I speak to everybody else, you know, lots of people that come to me, which I take as a, you know, it's a massive privilege for me. They don't want people to know because they think they're going to be judged. And we need to stop judging, because as soon as I started speaking out about it, my inbox is flooded every day. And you name it, from, you know, from a, you know, little Johnny who's four, maybe not four, but, you know, all walks of life, a different race, religion, gender, jobs, you know, CEOs, to, you know, everybody is suffering with mental health, as we know, but everybody says to me it's like a dirty little secret. They don't want to quite talk about it, just in case someone's going to then maybe fire them, or and that does, you know, and that actually evidence does suggest that that is still happening. You know, I've got a friend of mine that's been discriminated against in the workplace, in civil service, funnily enough, because of a mental health issue. And, you know, I think everyone's pretending to an extent that they're getting it, but they're not really. People are still, I think, jumping through hoops and trying to palm it off because they don't quite understand it. And that is the point of mental health. Everybody needs to understand and have education. It doesn't matter who they are or how old they are. Everyone needs to know. It's never too late to learn.
Thank you.
Good, thank you. Rowan?
Hi, I'm Rowan. I wondered, following on from what Pega said, could you tell us some of the methods you use to improve your mental well-being?
Sure, my personal ones or the ones I teach?
It's both, please. Yeah.
Okay, so that's the reason why I trained as a counsellor and life coach, was because I discovered these therapies that worked for me. I think there's a place for medication, I do. I think GPs are very quick to put people on medication. However, and I will do this in defence of doctors and GPs to an extent, because, as I understand, the training is insufficient in the mental health area. It is potluck whether you get a GP that knows what they're talking about or has a natural compassion and bedside manner to be able to deal with what, you know, what you're feeling when you're going in. Antidepressants do have a place, however, they are an incredibly difficult medication to wean yourself off, I find, and I believe and I see with people. They are also, to my knowledge and again evidence with my clients, it is not monitored enough either. I have clients of mine that have been on antidepressants for 8 years and they don't even remember why they were put on them. When I ask, have they had a review? No. So they've never had a review. There is so much inconsistency with it. My GP is fantastic, you know, they wheel me in every 5 minutes, you know, to check, you know, if I need anything, you know, but that is shocking. And then coming off an antidepressant is actually, the side effects are horrific, but there is a place for them. In my opinion though, we can be really, as apart from a quick fix, because it's not a quick fix, you stick someone on an antidepressant, yeah, it works to an extent, we need a little bit of time to let ourselves just calm down, have a little bit of breathing space mentally, let those chemicals do their job and just balance everything out so we can start to think clearly again. Because that's the point. You can't, how on earth can you pull yourself out of that black hole, you know, or whatever's happening with you, if you haven't had some help to get you there in the first place? So I believe there is a place for them for certain age groups and for certain people. However, they need to be, in my opinion, in conjunction with therapies, with talking therapies. Never underestimate the power of talking therapies. And I love nothing more than when I get someone that has successfully come off a medication, having had no talking therapy, and the talking therapy works. And that goes to show, when you're on a medication, all it's doing is blocking the problem. You're not actually tackling why you're feeling like that in the first place. There comes a point when you will come off them, one hopes, and the problem still exists. So we need to get into the cognitive, we need to think about it, we need to talk about our feelings, what's going on, is there a block there, is there something in the past, is there something we haven't been able to vocalise to somebody else. So for me, I'm very inarticulately trying to explain my therapies, I had NLP, neuro-linguistic programming, a combination of that, CBT, EFT, these are all kind of different combinations of things. But you know what, essentially, I've got to chat to someone who gave me the time of day. And one of the young ladies said in the last session about, you know, GPs, when she said one thing, GPs smile, Yes, just smile going in to talk to anyone is absolutely petrifying. It doesn't matter whether you're going in for, you know, a physical problem, but a mental health problem, my goodness, it's the most exposing thing you can do. Talking about your feelings is the most exposing thing anyone can do. Telling someone you love them is the most exposing. You know, let's not talk about problems in any way of talking about feelings. So you need to have someone that's receptive to that. You know, and if a GP genuinely can't be that person, well, maybe don't do that role of GP. Maybe there has to be specific GPs or one, two in, or healthcare workers within a GP practice that is trained to take those kind of patients, because it's so important you get the reception that you need. I got that reception. Someone that got it, made me feel normal, said to me, when do you want to be back at work? Now I'm going to lose my job. Right, we'll get you back to work. It was so not a stress coming from him, made me go, oh, thank God for that. Someone gets it, someone's going to help me. Brilliant, someone's going to help me. So talking therapies was fantastic. And I then, myself, trained as a counsellor, life coach, and as a neurolinguistic practitioner, which I find is an incredible way of actually learning about yourself and your feelings in the here and the now. And we've talked about mindfulness, that's very in vogue, and I think mindfulness should be rolled out as part of a curriculum, quite frankly. And actually, I do know of a school, someone was telling me yesterday about their daughter starting a secondary school, and they've automatically enrolled the GCSE year, first year GCSEs, into a 12-week mindfulness programme for that year, which I think is incredible, because as a counsellor, a young person's counsellor, when exam stress comes about, it's absolutely critical the amount of young people that just need that support and someone that can understand them.
How can you share those strategies? I know you've kind of shared it through training as a counsellor, but what advice would you give to other young people as to how to share strategies?
Well, do you know what? I think it's not just about young people, I think it's about parents as well. Because I think opening up to your parents is incredibly difficult, but I think arguably parents need to start parenting again. They need to start like actually listening to their kids and what's going on. As a counsellor, we know that exam stress is 200% up, and a lot of that for young people telling us is because of the pressure they're getting from parents. Now, on one hand, sounds great. Parents are being, you know, want their children to do well in school. But there needs to be an understanding of what actually the impact that is having on young people, and giving them an opportunity to be able to talk about how they're feeling. I think schools plays a huge part in this. Schools really need to get on board. You know, schools I do think have come on quite a bit with the counsellors, you know, and that's really encouraging. And I think just being able to talk about mental health within the schools as the norm, which it is and it should be, and stopping any of that, which will, you know, eventually start, certainly the next generation, if this continues the way it's going, you know, will help to eradicate any of that sort of, you know, horrible name calling, you know, psycho, you know, horrible derogatory stigmatizing name calling. I think will go a long way to people accepting others and indeed themselves. So I would say just find that buddy, certainly for young person, find someone you feel comfortable that you can at least just sort of start to open up to. And if that's a teacher, I think that's a really good thing. But teachers need to be well equipped to be able to deal with that too. We need to support our teachers. There's no point back giving that, saying, there you go, you deal with it. They need that support, you know, and it's no good parents saying to teachers, you deal with it. Parents need to wise up, and they need to get education as well about how to cope and support their kids as best as they can, because it will only increase family relationships. And we know that family relationships is the number one concern for young people. So I think that plays a huge part in this whole process.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Ryan?
Hello, I'm Ryan. What can people do if they have a friend, family member, or even a colleague who's experiencing mental health problems? What can they do to help them?
Being a buddy is so important. First thing is, if you know, do you know what? Just saying that simple question, how are you? Is so key. It's so, and this is the thing, and this comes back to the mindfulness thing as well, in a way. Mindfulness is so simple. It's just being in the here and the now, just letting everything else just block out for a minute. Just stop. Life is so pacey. And just being able to take a step back and just checking out, give them a double take almost, and just check to see if your mate, family member, friend, whatever, is okay. Ask them that question. We're all programmed to go, I'm fine. Now we're not fine. it means you're anything but fine, you know. So, but you know, but then to suddenly go, actually, I'm not fine. I have a huge mental health problem and I need to see a doctor. No one's going to say that. It's just starting to get that conversation going and go, well, if you ever need to talk, I'm here. Just saying that word to a friend or someone, just knowing that they aren't alone. Because when you have a mental health issue, as I have had, it is the loneliest feeling in the whole wide world. And you just want someone to turn around and say, I am not going to judge you. I don't care what you say. I will listen to you and I will just let you offload. It really can be, in some cases, as simple as that.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Ewan?
Hello, I'm Ewan.
Hi.
Like in your role as a mind ambassador, what would you say were are the best ways to improve mental health awareness and also to sort of eliminate the stigma all across the UK?
That's a big question, my friend. Eliminating stigma across the UK, I mean, this is something I've been massively campaigning for on the campaign, and I will continue to, probably to the day I die. This stigma is just ridiculous, especially when you look at the statistics. How do we go about combating stigma? Communication and education, and being real. Stop tiptoeing around it, you know. And I think, to be honest, that also means that people like me that have been there can help people that haven't been there, and we hope never will get there, by being really open about it. Because I totally get it. People are frightened to say the wrong thing. You know, it's like, oh God, I've just said crazy, oh no, I'm gonna, you know, and it's I'm speaking personally there. I'm not saying that anybody, you know, might get offended, they might, but I think it's just opening up that dialogue a bit and going, it's okay, you know, the PC brigade, you know, absolutely. But at the same time, I think we also have to really get it out there to be able to understand it truly, the terminology, what's acceptable, what isn't acceptable, why it's not acceptable. I think that's the thing, I think we're still at the infancy of it. That if someone does use a derogatory word in, with regards to a mental health illness, if they truly don't understand what they've said and why that is rude or discriminatory or full of stigma, as opposed to going, oh my God, they don't understand, you know, explain it, give that opportunity to go, well, listen, you said that, and this is actually how we feel about that word being used. Let's try different terminology. We've done it with all different things in this world, haven't we? We've changed language, we've changed perceptions, so they are more, so they're correct, you know, so everyone feels listened to and everyone feels equal. It's exactly the same thing. Some of the mental health illness is you, it's me, it's everybody. We just need to start talking about it, and by communicating it, by educating it, and most importantly for me is by not being scared of it, we can start to remove that stigma. And also not labelling, because like a physical illness, a mental illness, you can just as easily get over. Not in all cases, and I know people say this to me on Twitter sometime, how can you say that? I've had depression for 18 years. I totally empathise and get that. However, you can have a physical illness that can last you a lifetime too. All I'm saying is don't judge someone or label someone because they've had a bout of a mental health illness and then stick that label on them as a lesser citizen or a lesser employee or a lesser friend or an unreliable family member. Don't put that on them. Give them that opportunity to get better, get what help they need, support them, and then let them carry on with their life. And that for me is so important, which is why I say to people now, wait, okay, you're not gonna employ me, or not going to be my mate just because I had a breakdown 10 years ago. Well, actually, I feel sorry for them because I'm more for them that it'll be them or someone they know that will then be suffering later in life, which I don't want them to happen, but they'll then go, oh yeah, she had a point. And for me, that's it. It's just being real. Just let's talk about this. Let's cut the poop and just, you know, let's just start talking about it and stop skirting around the topic, you know, because it winds me right up.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Liam.
It's a pleasure to have you here, Williamson.
Then,
thank you. So I'm a little bit more informal than this. I have my feet out. I just realised this. I think this is covered, and I'm like sticking my feet out. I'm sorry.
It's a pleasure to meet you. My name's Liam Nissan.
We understand, well, the committee does understand that you were on agony aunt on this morning, which was quite exciting. I'm assuming.
From time to time.
Obviously, you have an experience within that field. Mm. What sort of messages would people like to hear in terms of your sort of idea about it?
So viewers-wise, yeah. Do you think? Well, I mean, I sort of, I specific, specialise, kind of speak, in young people. But I have my own private practice, so I have, you know, lots of you know, adults and, you know, whoever needs the help, you know. I don't discriminate. But for me specifically, with something like this morning, and I'm currently doing bits and bobs on Big Brother's bit on the side, which is a whole new ball game, watching the housemates. What feedback I get from my magazine columns and things that I do, which is very agony art based as well, is people need awareness. They need to be told they don't understand. And I specifically speak a lot to parents. And parents, so many I speak to are desperate to know what to do. They don't understand. And this is the thing, it is a generation that hasn't been quite so open about it. You know, my mother, they didn't talk about their feelings. You know, my mum, it was a culture thing. You know, no one did that, you know, arguably. So it's be good to sort of filter down now, because this generation is starting to kind of come out a little bit more, we hope, but there's a long way to go with it. A lot of it is parents, desperate parents, and teachers and adults that want to know how to help their young people. They don't know, their young person, you know, is sitting upstairs in bed in their bedroom, self-harming, eating disorder, you name it, whatever, self-medicating, whatever it may be, and they don't know how to help or support their child. And because of the lack of services out there as well, you know, so many parents are faced with a brick wall. They want to help, but they don't know how on earth to go about getting it. So, for me, there needs to just be so much support for parents. If I could wave a magic wand with the government and if they said, well, what? I would say, as well as teachers and healthcare professionals and GPs, give opt-in, maybe even opt-out actually, parenting classes to deal with mental health, how to understand your teen, you know, because parents aren't experts, you know, we just go with the flow. We hope for the best and you crack on and hope, you know, your kid's going to be one of the lucky ones that doesn't have a mental health issue. But you're living in cloud cuckoo land, you know. People need to be educated, yeah. And that's what I get time and time again.
Yeah. If you could, obviously, you know, the journey that you went through from a young age, it doesn't, you know, represent you as a person or anything like that. Obviously, it does represent a part of you, but you shouldn't be blamed for that, in my opinion. But if you could have experienced something different 10, 15 years ago, or something could have been done differently to support you in terms of your mental health struggle, if you like. What would you have wanted at that time?
Great question. Really great question. I don't think I've even been asked that before, and that's a really nice question to be asked. I mean, just to precede that, I mean, this is what, for me, is interesting as well. I had an idyllic childhood, you know. I couldn't ask for a better family. Support, friends, you know, weren't hard up. You know, I never struggled. I was lucky and didn't really get bullied either. You know, you could not stick something on me to go, that's why I've suffered from that. And for me, that was the absolute crux of it. Because I was like, what is wrong? Like, you know, I almost wanted to have some horrendous incident in my life where I could stick blame on it for. But this is the point, you know, mental health issues can happen to anybody. And I have been that person. You know, my poor parents, I think, you know, they blamed themselves for a time, you know. Oh, goodness, it's us as parents, you know. And you take on that responsibility and that guilt because you're like, well, no, you're great parents, actually. And it's not your fault, you know. So it is just about having that awareness. And if I could go back to 10 years ago, what I would have wanted would have been support from my mum, if I'm honest with you, and support for me too, because I could see how much it was upsetting her and how desperate she felt, but she wasn't getting the support. So I was in no place to be ringing around doctors. I was, you know, crying my eyes out in bed with her. You know, she needed the support. So there needs to be awareness and for people somewhere where friends, we gave the question about friends, or that other person can help you for you. Because when you're in the grip of a mental health illness, you don't even know your own name half the time, let alone going through all this bump and literature. You know, I'm a healthcare professional with my own practice now, yet I struggle trying to find the support for some of my clients, and I got access to it. So if I struggle, having been there, done it, got every qualification under the sun, and I struggle to find support for clients, how on earth does someone that is going through their mental health issue in the here and now, how on earth do they access it? It's impossible.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Jessica?
So
So you spoke a lot about
parents getting support and healthcare professionals, but if there were young people themselves who are struggling with mental health issues, what would be the one thing you'd say to them to help them get through it?
Yeah, do you know what? First thing I say, and I do say, is you're not alone. Now, it doesn't take it away, but for me and for everyone, a lot of people do say they empathise with the lonely feeling. It's power in numbers, so it's finding that buddy. If you're feeling on your own, try and reach out as much as you can. Identify somebody that you feel you can talk to. Now, if you feel you can't talk to a parent, and I get that because maybe sometimes the parents are part of the cause, you know, giving you the stress, you know, or whatever it may be, you know, and let's be honest, you know, we'll be teenagers, you know, parents give us stress, right? And maybe I probably would have loved an offload at the age of 14, 15, you know, when I was having a, you know, strop or something. I would say identify someone that you feel you can talk to, whether that is a teacher, whether that's a friend's mum, usually that's quite a good outlet. Just don't suffer in silence on your own, and before you even feel that urge to do something about it, so whether that means self-medicate or take other actions when we're starting to get down that road, if you can feel any part of you, just try and identify that one person. And if you can't find that one person physically to talk to, then there are, you know, Mind, for example, can help, you know, and the younger charities and Childline. Try and reach out and ask someone to help. There is no shame with asking for help. In fact, if anything, it's the bravest thing anyone can ever do.
Thank you.
Saskia?
You talked about early intervention quite early on. And obviously educating people on how to help each other and peer support and all of that is quite vital. But I was just wondering if you thought that in general there's almost too much focus put on the negative aspects of mental health as opposed to saying, here's how to be a really healthy, happy person, promoting resilience and stuff like that. It was just,
you are totally right with that, and that's how I actually work. Part of life coaching is in NLP is it's just flicking that sentence from I'm not going to feel rubbish today to I'm going to feel great today. Just by changing that sentence gives a whole different tone. You know, I'm not going to feel rubbish today, I'm going to feel great today. Now, I'm giving a very broad example of that. But yeah, what was the question again?
It was whether you thought there was too much
negativity. That was it. I absolutely agree with you, and I think that's why. I'm not saying I'm maverick at all with it, but I'm very, very serious about mental health. But there's a time and a place for it. You know, there's a time and a place for it here, but there's also a time and a place for me to go, I would never say it's no big deal. But what I would say is, because it is, but it's also part of life. And I think you're absolutely right. We focus far too much on the negativity. The press don't help. Media don't help with some of these, you know, sensationalised headlines, which, you know, madman this, you know, and they focus on one aspect of that sometimes. There is too much negative connotation of mental health. Yeah, everyone has a bit of a blip. Don't get me wrong, there are some obviously very severe cases too, but it's like any form of health. For me, I would say the best thing ever happened to me was getting panic attacks, you know, and that sounds like an odd sentence, but it meant I learned about myself. I learned who I was, why I got them. I ditched the boyfriend, which was a good move. And I got this fabulous career, which I love, and I'm sitting here talking to you fine people. You know, it's looking for that positive and going, well, this doesn't have to define me. If anything, I've got more work as a result of it. You know, it sounds a bit random, but I have. So I turn it to a huge positive.
Yeah, so do you think part of the education process then needs to be promoting resilience and seeing
Absolutely.
Things as a positive?
Absolutely. And saying, don't worry, you know, there really is a light at the end of the tunnel. There can be. You know, yeah, we have to, of course, be serious in it. There's no point being all happy-clappy if someone's in the grips of, you know, exam stress and depression or whatever. But just to go, well, that's that. But then there's a gear change, and we need to see where there can be an end goal as well, and where there's life after that little blip you might have had. You know what? You might revisit that blip in life. But it doesn't have to mean the end of the world. It doesn't have to mean your life changes. It doesn't mean you have to rethink your career path. It just means it's one of those things. Like, we always have one of these things. I don't like flying very much, you know. But you know what? I still get on a plane. You know, sometimes I love it, sometimes I hate it. It's just one of those things. And that's how I sort of liken it, really.
Thank you.
Thank you. Liam?
Thank you. I just
just wanted to ask a question about when, you know, you meet with young people and you, you know, you take in emails, letters, whatever, and you hear about their stories, and you must have that connection with them perhaps. And when you see a young person that's gone through what you've gone through, do you feel a sense of pride after you've supported them or, you know, messaged them back to say, give advice?
Huge. It's fantastic. And I feel very honoured and very privileged. I know it sounds really cheesy, but I genuinely do, because it's something, a real negative from my past. I took that path to find out about it, to understand it, and to move forward with it, which I've done. So I made that choice, and I'm really chuffed I made that choice. So when I meet a young person that, of course, they don't know that because they haven't done all the studying that I've done, but yeah, to be able to kind of empathise with them, and I find that people like the fact and trust the fact that I haven't just not just sitting there with a, you know, grey suit and a stethoscope and, you know, and not a smile on my face, and I'm just very real about it. You know, I'm a bit like, you know, feeling a bit rubbish. Yeah, yeah, I get that. You know, and it's just been, it's relating to their language, and I think that's also very important, that people don't have to start speaking ghetto, obviously, but, you know, it's about relating to young people and not treating, you know, one size fits all. Everyone is unique and individual, and something might work with one person, but it might not work with somebody else. And that, I think, is very, very important. You know, CBT, which I think is great, is rolled out now, which is fab. But there are a lot of people that don't actually get on with that. So what's the alternative? And then I pick up a lot of people that say, well, I'm a failure. I'm clearly uncurable because that didn't work for me. And one could argue and go, well, you know, we've tried. You know, what else can we do? I get that. I get that. But again, it's not just saying that every single one of you, if you needed it, would respond exactly the same way to exactly the same treatment. And that is where mental health needs to be really looked at, you know, and options need to be given. And each person, case by case, needs to be considered as a human being.
Thank you.
Okay.
Hello again.
Hi.
Well, basically, there's one thing I've really recognised in mental health issues is mental health issues existing at home. So, for example, my question is, what can parents do to support their child if, as a parent, they suffer from mental health issues then anyway?
Okay.
So it's more like, you know, like a double domino effect. How can a parent support their child and themselves at the same time, because I think that's a huge, huge responsibility on its own. So what are your opinions and suggestions?
Yeah, no, great question. And also on the flip side of that as well, it's young people that are coping that haven't yet displayed any or aren't concerned about mental health problem themselves, but are coping with a parent that has a very, very, you know, severe mental health issue. So there does need to be an awful lot more support there for young people, I think, as well as parents. And what I would suggest from that as well, there needs to be some form of family therapy. There needs to be a real understanding, you know, and support there for it, because a lot of it can, some mental health, like a lot of physical illness, can be hereditary. You know, depression can be quite hereditary, you know, and anxiety and panic attacks. There's a whole line of it in my family, you know. So it's, again, education, you know, and knowing who else you can tap into, and really looking at who that support network is around your family, knowing when you need to talk, but also knowing when you need to break away and you need to have that space and that me time, and doing something for yourself which is fulfilling in yourself, and again asking for help. And yeah, that is a tricky one when parents are suffering with a mental health issue and they're looking after a child that is also, then it can start to exacerbate, and neither, because how can you support somebody when you're going through it yourself? So there needs to be a greater awareness, and there needs to be a greater support surrounding that at the moment, which I don't think really exists all that well.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Just to pick up on your previous point around the media, and it's, you talked about negativity and negative campaigns they've done towards mental health. Do you feel there's a responsibility on the media to help reduce mental health stigma?
Yeah, massively. I mean, I know that, I mean, I work in the media as well, you know, and it absolutely makes my blood boil when you see headlines saying, you know, let's take, a bit controversial, I know, but the German Wings pilot, you know, the headline for that was Madman in the Cockpit. And it went on to focus on the fact that he'd, I'm generalising here, but he suffered with chronic depression, I think it was, or something. Now, I'm not at all defending that situation. It was absolutely flipping horrific. However, straight away, boom, the easy option is let's blame it on him being mentally unstable. We don't know what happened in that. However, because the media then latch onto that, it basically undoes all the good work that charities such as Mind and trying to get that sort of destigmatisation out there, it really does undermine it. And it, straight away people go, ah, there you go, mental health problem. As soon as you have a mental health problem, you're going to kill a load of people. You know, and that, and the media do have a responsibility. The same thing happened with Robin Williams. I can't remember what the headline was, but I know it focused heavily around his depression, bipolar. I can't actually remember exactly what it was. But again, it's all speculation. And when it's speculation, and when the easy option is to just target sort of the mental health side of it, it's actually completely irresponsible. And all it does is makes anybody that is even remotely feeling depressive or anything like that feel like they're a lesser person, feels that they're going to get a label because, oh, it's on the front page of the tabloid, so that must mean that I'm going to be lumped into that. And people do. They go, oh, he was depressed. Oh, she's depressed. Well, look what he, you know, and it does. It carries these negative connotations. You know, yeah, let's be honest. Of course, some people, you know, do have mental health issues and bad things do happen. But those are the few things that are reported on. But it makes a great story, and that's what we listen to and we read. But what it is doing is it is totally missing the point and undermining the other vast amount of mental health illnesses that people are brilliantly coping with, brilliantly dealing with, you know, serving police officers, army, lots of people suffer with mental health illnesses. So to be labelled with the, you know, the very minority that have done these sort of sensationalised bad acts absolutely makes a mockery of everything that we try and do with regards to destigmatisation of mental health.
Thank you. And just to ask the final question, if you can make one recommendation to the government, what would your recommendation be?
Stop wasting money on pointless crud. Just, do you know what? Early intervention. I know it's been said before, but seriously, the amount of people I see which you spend all of that time and money, or their time and money, unpicking what has happened in that 6 month, 10 month, year waiting list from when they suddenly went help. To say help, I need help now, is the most brave thing anyone can do when they're suffering from a mental health problem. So then go, great, there's a, you know, appointment a year down the line. Well, just have to sit with that for, what, if I had to sit with that for it, how I felt, I had to sit with it for a day. That's how lucky I was. If I had to sit with it for a year, I dread to think what I would have done. I genuinely even fantasize, I've said this before so it's not news, but I remember at the time fantasizing about crashing my car and then sort of breaking a leg. I remember thinking, oh, I'd be great because then I could just be in hospital for a bit and everyone would leave me alone. Now that was in a week. Imagine how people feel they're having to cope and waiting for this appointment, which they're then getting themselves in a stress about anyway because it's scary to go and have an appointment. Early intervention, don't leave people waiting, and don't let the problem become another problem. So then you're actually treating about five problems with five different resources. That's five different sets of money that has to be found from somewhere to treat the alcohol, the drugs, the self-harm, the this, the that. Treat the problem there and then. Get people appointments within 10 days, 2 weeks, and you know what? You'll save yourself a bucket load of cash down the line.
That's great. Thank you ever so much for your time and joining us today. We've really enjoyed it. Thank you.
Thank you, likewise.
And with that, we close the fifth panel.
Oh, I thank you. It's Friday.